Amen. Amen.
So you can go to Isaiah 52, verse 13. That's where we're going to begin. You know, when I was a young man in college, I remember doing a report, and I was a history major eventually. I'm not sure I was at the time. I was taking a course in history in college, and we had a panel, and we all took certain parts of history. So we took, as I remember, the Renaissance, Reformation, Renaissance, you know, and of course I was a lost person, perhaps searching at the time, but I think this kind of made me search. But as I read about the Renaissance, and then I saw that maybe that's what caused the Reformation, you know, maybe the Reformation caused the Renaissance, you know, I couldn't. But what I realized was that at the time, there were times there where the Bible was banned. They didn't want people reading the Bible because it would enlighten them. Of course, enlightened people, that's why parts of Europe where the Renaissance was very strong, became very prosperous. I wonder how did that ever happen? But you know, people's minds were opened and they were free and they gained freedoms and they were able to really prosper and the cities were great. Now, so we know that the Bible is something that is for everyone to read. In the Old Testament, that happened also in the Old Testament times, and or maybe right up to the present, there is some one part of Scripture that seems to be historically has been banned by some rabbis. They want the young people to read it, and that would be Isaiah 53 and 52. And it turns out that Isaiah was even the meaning of his name really talks about salvation and freedom, you know, in Christ, and that we need a Messiah. And so it opened up a lot of eyes. And you wonder, we always think of having the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, those four Gospels, right? Well, what about if I told you there's a fifth Gospel? Only it's in the Old Testament, not in the New. And that's really what you have with Isaiah. And Isaiah was so clearly talking about Jesus Christ that it's hard for someone who denies Christ, the divinity of Christ, and his importance to the world and to the spiritual life of the world, would have to ban it because it just is so clear. So that's where we're going to go today. And we see, this morning we were looking at the angels announcing the birth of Jesus Christ, and we even read the birth of Jesus Christ to Mary and Joseph, and how what a celebration that was. And we talked about, if you remember, why did God choose to go to the shepherds, to the poor shepherds, worshiping? And of course, I remember David was, when he was worshiping up in the mountains, you know, he had a great relationship with God. And God loved him so much because of that relationship, he anointed him king. And so David had a heart that God loved. And these shepherds had that potential, I think, because God chose to announce, rather than to the authorities who were so far away from God's will, and were sheep, wolves, you might say, scripturally they were wolves in sheep clothing, they went to the real shepherds, the common man. They represented the common person. We have today a whole world that is lost, and they are being misled by their leaders. And sometimes it's a generational thing. They're misled for whole generations, and even hundreds of years. But here, in Isaiah's day, it was a time of a very needy type of dryness, a time where the gospel was not there. So much so that Isaiah, you know, thought he was all alone. You know, maybe I'm the only one that really believes, you know, anymore. And so, we find that Isaiah 52:13 and 53:12 is all about the suffering Savior and his atoning death. The Jewish rabbis will probably tell you that this is about the nation of Israel and how they have suffered. But it's clearly about an individual. Clearly, if you take it, the Bible literally, you see Christ in the earth. And so this, you might say, is the Mount Everest of biblical prophecy in the Old Testament. 700 years, might be almost 800 years before Christ, we find a clear rendition of who he is. In this chapter, the Savior of the world is seen suffering for the sins of the human race. That's what it is. It's not about the nation, because the nation did suffer, but the sins of the human race. And the scene and meaning of his death are described in surprising detail. For true believers, Isaiah 53 is one of the most heartbreaking, yet cherished passages of the scripture. For it describes the brutal treatment and horrible suffering Christ endured on our behalf. A marked feature of Isaiah 53 is the vicious substitutionary death of God's suffering servant, the promised Messiah. There's only one like that. It has to be Jesus Christ. Emphasizing this theme time and again, Isaiah predicts that the Savior will die for our sins. He will die in our place, on our behalf, in our stead, for us, as our substitute. You ever hear that before? Well, you hear it all through the New Testament. You hear every preacher of the New Testament scripture comes up with all those phrases. Well, Isaiah was saying that 800 years before Christ ever came, of our need for a Savior. Paying the penalty of sin for us, the Savior will set us free from the bondage of sin, death, and hell. Through his death, we have received from God the most amazing healing and salvation. We have been saved from the bondage of sin and death and from the coming terrifying judgment of God against all unrepentant sins. So Jesus Christ and the cross, right here in the Old Testament, that's what we have. Some may call this book 800 years ago the fifth gospel. St. Augustine called it the fifth gospel. St. Augustine could read it. Hundreds of years ago, but in the New Testament times, and said, well, that's just, it's like the other books of the New Testament. The name Isaiah means salvation of the Lord. But right away, you know where he's coming from. It is a plan for messianic salvation. There only ever was one way to heaven. Jesus is that way. Jesus is the way to heaven, to the few that will get there. You know, it's a narrow way. So often we hear people denigrating everything that we believe in the scripture, and you might get down and depressed about that, but don't be, because the scripture's clear. It's only a few that's going to get to heaven, okay? Those who receive the truth of the gospel. No other way to heaven is provided. Try as you may, you cannot get to heaven without Jesus Christ. Better men have tried and are in hell today because of it. That's scary for me because my father used to tell me that there were many ways to heaven. It wasn't just Jesus. He said that every country or every civilization had their own way of expressing God. But it was still God's way to get to heaven. Because I didn't believe that at all. I didn't believe it when he was telling me that. And he did come around and receive Christ as a Savior himself. Because there is no other way. Jesus Christ is the only way. I am the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus said. No man comes to the Father but by me. That's from the lips of Jesus himself. Isaiah was thought to be a well-educated and cultured son of a prince of Judah. He served 40 years as a prophet and served under four kings. But legend has it that he died as a humble death, sawed in two for his family. He was by King Manasseh. He served in the reign of those four kings, a great ministry of good times and bad, because some of those kings were good, you know, some not. And so he had some good and bad, but he died for his faith. So we know the salvation. What he's telling us then is that salvation is of the Lord. It is a free gift. You're not going to win it through religion. A marked feature of Isaiah 53 is the vicarious substitutionary death of Jesus Christ. Now let's take a look at Isaiah 52, verse 13, because that's really the beginning of this particular story. Remember, oftentimes these chapters are just imposed upon the text. So in verse 13 it says, "Behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high." Now, I mentioned this morning out of Philippians chapter 2, verses 7 through 11, actually through 9. So if you want to go there, you can. But here, it tells that his servant, Jesus Christ, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in the fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." That means that everybody in heaven one day is going to acknowledge, in hell even, is going to have to acknowledge who Jesus Christ is. Now you can see how in harmony this is. Jesus Christ came into the world at a time when it was very, very dry. And they weren't ready, and they would not be ready to receive Christ. But Christ would be, remember, it starts out with victory. So whenever we come here on Christmas morning, or if we come here even on Easter morning, we always read about victory in Christ. But as you go through the life of Christ, you see so many very hard times. But the idea is, the victory is always in Christ. And so it is in our lives. We go through hard times, but we always know that the victory is in Christ. That he will be exalted, and he has been exalted on high. That he is on the throne even right now, and he is in control. And so we win. So we want to remember that the salvation then is going to be a free gift earned by him. Now, before I even start, what Isaiah is getting at is that that God wants us all to be in heaven with him, but mankind, we have not accepted it. We've turned away from God. We've turned our back on God, and so while God wants to give us heaven, give us eternal life, we turn our back on God, and so we have a problem. And it's universal. It's every human being. Without a Savior, your sins cannot be forgiven, and so none of us have any chance of getting into heaven. But God gave us, and that's what Isaiah is telling us about, that God, into this dry world, this sinful world, God would one day, 800 years, he didn't know how many years it was going to be, 800 years later, would come Jesus Christ, the Messiah, who would live out his life, die for us, and any who receive him, any who turn their hearts over to him, and surrender to Christ, and make him the Lord of their life, and are sincere, they will receive eternal life. Isaiah understood that long before Christ ever came. Isn't it a shame that Israel, we're still awaiting Israel's coming to know that. Now, what we're going to look at here is the prophecy. We're going to go over 10, very quickly, I hope, 10 prophecies that are in Isaiah 53 that could only be Jesus Christ. There's nobody else that could possibly be. And so there's in Isaiah there are 754 verses that are prophecy. The book, if you read through it, is 59%. As you read that book, 59% of the book is prophecy. It's foretelling the future. Boy, did God give Isaiah a whole handful of truth. Here are 10 prophecies from Isaiah. First off, we just read, he will be exalted. He will be exalted. So that one we know in Philippians chapter 2. It's told that he, even now, is in heaven. And he's exalted. Everyone is bending the knee to him. Number two, in Isaiah 52:14, and Isaiah 53:2, let's go to 53:2, it says, for he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. We talked this morning about how Jesus Christ was born to a poor carpenter in a stable that's, I'm sure, stuck, because I've been in those stables. I've been in one like that in the Middle East. It was just stuck. And it was unclean. And it was the most humble beginning that you could possibly have, you know. It says, as many as were astonished that his visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So this Jesus Christ who came into the world so humbly, then we see that it would be beaten and would be marred to the point where you couldn't hardly look upon him. And we know that that happened with Pilate, Isaiah 53:2. Now Mark 15:17-19 says this, and they clothed him with purple, and plaited a crown of thorns, and put it about his head, and began to salute him, Hail, King of the Jews! And they smote him on the head with a reed, and did spit upon him, and bowing their knees, worshipped him. Of course, that was mocking worship in him. And so we see that was fulfilled with Jesus Christ. He was, the amazing thing was that Jesus Christ was the King of the Jews. He literally was the King of the Jews. And I guess Pilate was mocking the nation, and they're mocking the Savior. Who's the joke on? Well, all of them. Jesus Christ, again, has the victory. And he will make a blood atonement in Isaiah 52:15. Satan, you know, when Satan saw Jesus Christ put on the cross, he must have been rejoicing. Oh, man, look, I have the victory. I'm killing the Son of God, you know. And he knew about the Son because he waited on the Son in heaven. And now it says in Isaiah 52:14, so shall he sprinkle many nations. The king shall shut their mouths to him. For that which had not been told them shall they see, and that which they had not heard shall they consider. And In 1 Peter 1:2 it says, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you, and peace be multiplied. You know, if you really go back to even in Genesis, when Abraham was told that he was going to have, he's going to be father of a new nation, out of his loins was to come one son who would sprinkle all the nations, and that it was with his blood. That's what it meant with salvation. He was going to be a blessing. He's going to be a blessing to all the nations. And Jesus Christ, his blood is a blessing to all the nations. It's the only way for us to get to heaven. And so we see it both in the Old and New Testament. Isn't it something that how the Old and the New Testament are all written by the same Holy Spirit? Even though there are, 66 books and other many, many writers, all written by the same Holy Spirit. And it all fits together. If you understand it, if you read it as God meant it to be read, it all makes sense. And number four, he will be widely rejected. 53:1-3 says, who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when he shall see him, there is no beauty that they should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, He is a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. And John 12, 37, 38, the New Testament says, but though he had done so many miracles before them, yet they believed not any of them. That the saying of Isaiah, the prophet, might be fulfilled when he spake, Lord, who hath believed our report? And to whom hath the arm of the Lord been revealed? John's even telling us that that's a fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy that we just read. And he will bear our sins and sorrows. In Isaiah 53, 4 and 5. Oh man, I like that one. I preach that all the time. And he takes our sins and our sorrows. Now that also means on a day-to-day basis, if we put things in his hands, he lifts the burden off of our backs and gives us joy. And that was surely he had borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Now, in Romans 4, 25, it says, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. In 1 Peter 2, 24, 25, it says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes, I like this, we are healed. We think of the beating that he got, the whipping that he got, and how it just hurts our hearts. But we must realize that by this we were healed. Our sins are forgiven, for we were sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your soul. Well, our job is to tell other people, others who are right now still astray all around us. Most people are still astray. Some just a little bit, some a lot. But how much astray do you have to be if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior? One sin will send you to hell. And so almost everybody you know that does not know Christ, well, all of them that you know that don't know Christ, are lost today. He will be our substitute. That's the sixth one. Isaiah 53. He will be our substitute. 53 verses 6 and 8. Say, all we, my sheep, have gone astray, and we have turned to every one to his own way. The Lord hath laid on him iniquity was all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearer is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation, for he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgressions of my people was he stricken. In 2 Corinthians 5, 21, we get the answer of this prophecy, for he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The miracle of this is that Jesus Christ was the very Son of God. He was one essence with God. There was never a time in history, ever, when fellowship was broken between God the Father and God the Son. But for us, Jesus Christ became sin. The Father can't look upon sin. And fellowship was broken. Can you imagine the pain? I mean, that's when his heart just burst. The human heart couldn't handle it. Burst. It was just overwhelming. For us, he became sin. My sin, your sin, he suffered. And John 10, 11 says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for his sheep. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head, and he gave up the ghost. I think it's important to realize that Jesus Christ, no one could kill him. He gave up his life for us. Fellowship was broken with the Father, and it is finished, and he gave up his life. He will be buried in a rich man's tomb. I always like this one. This one kind of really sticks to me pretty good. Isaiah 53:9, it says, he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence. Neither was any deceit in his mouth. Now, that really makes it unique, because people can say, well, that could just be anybody. But Jesus Christ died a death on the cross, the only one that could go to the cross would be a non-citizen. It was something that was for the very lowest of the low in society. This was for the dregs of society. Jesus Christ was put on the cross and died the death. So that's the grave of the poor. But then, of course, Joseph of Arimathea came, and he took him. And he and Nicodemus, two rich men, had influence. Power, it was all politics back in those days. And they had the power to go to claim the body of Jesus Christ. And so it says, and after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, brought Pilate and besought Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him his leave. He came therefore and took the body of Jesus. And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night, and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pound weight. Then they took the body of Jesus, and wound it in linen cloth with the spices in the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now, in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new sepulchre, wherein was never man yet laid. They laid Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulchre was nigh at hand. So he went into Joseph Arimathea's tomb, a rich man. Nicodemus was one of the richest men in Israel. His family was very rich, and was known for generations. Very powerful men. And so Jesus Christ was put in the grave of the rich, that's the cross, and the tomb, the grave of the poor, which was the cross, and the grave of the rich man, which was the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. He will suffer us who believe in him. Now, I said that wrong. He will save us who believe in him. That's Isaiah 53:10. 11, it goes like this. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief when thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin. He shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days. And the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. What jumps out about that? I mean, we all understand that he's going to, he will save us who believe in him. Believers can say, mine.